So, please don't hesitate to ask questions. You may also intervene during my talk, but we'll have time for a discussion at the end of this presentation. What I'll do is give an overview on basic cellular mechanisms which we know occur during the different forms of heart failure, which are now described in literature. So, well, we all know heart failure is a huge issue in our society, and it's a disease of every age. But importantly, which was sort of found like 15 years ago, heart failure is not traditionally a reduction of contractility. So it's not that you have that all patients have a reduction in the left ventricular ejection fraction, but we now know that there's a large group of patients who have a preserved ejection fraction and rather have relaxation deficit, so impaired relaxation. And well, this shows the overview. It's sort of a 50-50 distribution of people who have heart failure with reduced ejection fraction or with a preserved ejection fraction. And we know that diastolic heart failure is related with obesity. It's very common in women, and we don't have a treatment currently for the group of people who have a preserved ejection fraction. And the terminology of this form of heart failure in how the cardiologists have used it changed a lot. So sort of around 2005, it was termed diastolic heart failure. But diastolic heart failure, impaired relaxation, is also present in patients. Sorry? Oh, I thought you were asking something. In patients which have a reduced ejection fraction. So they then, in 2009, went on to have heart failure with normal ejection fraction, but what's normal is because it's not so normal also in this group, and nowadays it's called HFpEF, so heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And lately, it's become even more complicated, at least for me as a basic scientist, because there's an additional classification described in the ESC guidelines. So we now also have this here, this heart failure with mid-range ejection fraction, which should be sort of between 40% and 49% ejection fraction. So the cardiologists try to classify the different patient groups. The problem is that we don't really have good treatments for this group, and in particular the people who have preserved ejection fraction but impaired relaxation. So if you sort of in general look at the remodeling of the heart and these groups of heart failure, you have the systolic heart failure or the HFrEF, who mostly show thinning of the wall, eccentric remodeling. Well, if you look at the diastolic heart failure group or the ones with preserved ejection fraction, it's sort of inward remodeling. We call it concentric remodeling. And the causes for these different forms of heart failure are very different, going from ischemic cardiomyopathy, so a coronary artery disease, which is causing systolic heart failure, to diabetes, obesity, leading to diastolic heart failure, but also genetic defects, which will be introduced to you tomorrow, are often causing either systolic or diastolic forms of heart failure and a similar form of remodeling of the heart. So this shows the characteristics of the heart occurring in these two extreme forms of heart failure. So it's systolic heart failure. You get a reduction of your contractility, which will lower stroke volume. So here, due to the reduction in contractility of the heart muscle, the heart has a lower ejection fraction. And I'll show you some of the cellular defects which we believe contribute to this reduced contractility. And on the other hand, we have the diastolic heart failure, which is shown at the very right panel. And here you see that while contractility parameter is preserved, there's increased filling, or the filling of the heart is prevented or limited because of stiffening of the ventricle, there's an impaired diastolic or relaxation of the heart muscle, which basically limits your filling and thereby also limits, again, the amount of blood pumped out into the circulation. But the contractility, the ejection fraction, is not changed. So when to understand the different cellular pattern mechanisms, I'll just briefly take you through the cardiac myocyte, to which you should know, but just to briefly go through it. When the cardiac muscle cells activated upon a trigger from the sinus node, the L-type calcium channels open and there's an influx of calcium into the cell, which then triggers calcium release from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And the calcium will bind to the myofilaments, shown at the right, and that will trigger a conformational change at the level of the troponin-tropomyosin complex. And the myosin heads combine to the fin filament, and you have the power stroke, the contraction. Now, after the power stroke and the calcium transient, the calcium declines again, and the calcium detaches from your sarcomeres, and it's taken up into the sarcoplasmic reticulum again via the SR calcium ATPase pump, CIRCA. And part of the and CIRCA is regulated by phospholamban. Phospholamban blocks CIRCA activity, so if you start to exercise, phospholamban, the break of phospholamban on CIRCA will be released. And then part of the calcium is also pumped out of the cell via the sodium calcium exchanger. And I highlight this because I'll show you a study where changes in the sodium calcium channel protein expression have been found in a human study. So there's a very tight interaction between the calcium cycling and binding of calcium to the myofilaments, which leads to proper contraction and also to relaxation of the heart muscle cells. Now, if you look at the myofilament properties, once calcium is released, calcium will bind to the myofilament, and you can assess the properties of the myofilaments by exposing the myofilaments to different levels of calcium, shown here. And if you increase calcium concentration, you will get an increase in force development, and this sort of mimics the situation in the systolic and diastolic phase of the cardiac cycle. So you can imagine if the properties of the myofilaments to bind calcium change, this will change your force development of the heart. Now, what changes in systolic heart failure, and I'll go back really a long time, when the first studies were performed in looking at the calcium transient in patients with systolic heart failure. And those are really elegant studies where they isolated single cardiomyocytes and they studied the force development but also the calcium transient. And what was striking in the different studies is that there's a drop in the maximal calcium concentration, while at relaxation phase, during the diastolic phase, there's a higher calcium concentration. So this is already a long time ago that these studies were done, and this basically shows in the lower panel, you have the calcium transient of a control cardiomyocyte, a nice increase in your calcium and a drop in calcium during the diastolic phase to get relaxation. But if you look at the cells from a dilated heart, you can see that there's a drop in your calcium transient in the systolic phase, so that would mean that there's less calcium available to stimulate the myofilaments, while during that relaxation phase, there's actually an increase. So once you want to relax the myofilaments, there's too much calcium around. So this would also limit your relaxation. Another thing which was observed is that if you pace the cardiac myocytes, so you increase frequency as you would do during exercise, normally you would have an increase in force development, as shown for the non-failing hearts. But when you look at single cardiomyocytes isolated from hearts which have end-stage systolic heart failure, this is severely blunted. So also they do not respond properly when you increase frequency. So to briefly summarize what's seen in heart failure with the systolic dysfunction, we see a prolonged calcium transient. There are high calcium levels during the relaxation phase. And during the systolic phase, the intracellular calcium levels are actually lowered. They're decreased. And there's a negative force frequency relation. So I'll just show one thing which is now really known and causing or contributing to the reduced calcium transient in systolic heart failure, and that's a drop in the circa. So the SR calcium ATPase pump, in many different studies, both animal studies and human studies, we know that during cardiac development there's a reduction of the expression level of the circa pump. And you can imagine if there's less circa, less calcium will be pumped back into the SR. And so calcium will stay around during the relaxation phase. So it could explain the prolonged calcium transient and the high calcium levels during relaxation. And then less calcium is stored in the SR. So upon the next beat, less calcium is available to be released from the SR. And this will also lower your systolic calcium levels. There are, of course, many other changes in calcium handling proteins, but this is a very important one. And the studies which were done, Roger Ajar was involved in these. They performed studies in a rat model where they introduced a myocardial infarction, and they showed that the failing heart shift to very narrow, pressure-volume relations. So there's a severely dilated heart with low contractility, and they provided with adenoviral transfer circa to the failing heart, and then you can see that this whole pressure-volume relationship shifted back towards what's seen in the sham-operated animals. So this showed that circa is an important player in the reduced contractility and the remodeling of the heart upon a myocardial infarction. And if you give circa back, you can rescue part of the dysfunction seen in this model. And they also show that looking at mortality, so you can see that the failing animals do really not good. They almost all die after 25 days. If you give the circa with the adenovirus, they do much better, and they are in between the sham-operated and the failing animals. They also performed, the same group performed studies in single cardiomyocytes which were isolated from the end-stage human heart, and also there they did overexpression of circa to see if they could correct the changes in the calcium transients and the contractility of human cardiomyocytes. And indeed, they also showed for the human samples that you could correct the characteristics of the failing cardiomyocytes. So the first panel shows the blunted shortening of a single cardiomyocyte and a change in the calcium transient. This is a cell from a non-failing heart, and if you overexpress circa in the failing heart, you go back to the characteristics seen in the non-failing heart with a nicely looking calcium transient. And also looking at this force frequency relationship, which is highly blunted in a non-failing or in the failing heart, they could show that overexpression of circa into the failing heart cells rescued or basically normalized a large part of this blunted force frequency relationship and brought it back to the non-failing heart situation. So circa is important, but also phospholamban. As I told you, phospholamban blocks circa activity, and when you start to exercise, phospholamban is phosphorylated, and then this block is released, and more calcium can be pumped into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So this interaction, the ratio between circa and phospholamban, is very important in regulating the amount of calcium which can be pumped back into the SR. So many studies have shown a drop in circa, but if you also have a drop in phospholamban expression, the ratio may not change, and then it may not have such a big effect on your calcium transient. I showed you also that the sodium-calcium exchanger here at the sarcolemma is important. And there's a really elegant study from the group of Gert Hazenfuss who showed that the sodium-calcium exchanger is maybe an adaptation, maybe a rescue mechanism for the changes at the level of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And the way they showed this was by looking at different samples from failing human hearts, and they grouped them. So there, in all groups, group 1 to 3, they found a reduction in the expression of CIRCA. But there was one group where the sodium-calcium exchanger was upregulated, while in the most or in group 3 there was an unchanged calcium-sodium expression. And if you then look in the group where this increase in the sodium-calcium exchanger, in particular if you look at the diastolic force, which goes up in the group where there's no increase in the sodium-calcium exchanger, there's a severe increase in diastolic tension development, which is not seen in the group 1. So if you have an overexpression or an upregulation of the sodium-calcium exchanger, apparently this is a way to still remove calcium, which in the cytosol, from your cardiomyocyte, so it could be an adaptation of the heart to still maintain low levels of calcium during the diastolic phase. Okay, so these were just two examples of protein changes in the failing hearts, but of course there are also post-translational modifications, and I'll show you the phosphorylation changes, which are related to changes in the beta-adrenergic receptor signaling pathway. So just to refresh your memory, if you start to exercise, the cardiac myocytes need to work harder. They have to increase their contractility, so their sympathetic stimulation, so you'll have high attention development. But you also need a faster relaxation, so you need a positive lusitropic effect. Because you have this increase in heart rate, you also need to speed up all the processes which are happening at the cardiomyocyte level. So you need a faster activation and a faster relaxation. And that's all regulated at the level of calcium handling, which tightly communicate with your myofilaments. So if you look into this mechanism, you'll have, when you start to exercise, activation of your beta-adrenergic receptor, which leads to activation of protein kinase A. And then you have multiple proteins which are involved in the calcium cycling, which are being phosphorylated. So the L-type calcium channel and the ryanodine receptor are phosphorylated, which increases the calcium released upon activation. So you have more calcium available to bind to your myofilaments. But also after binding of calcium to the myofilaments and after the contraction, the calcium needs to go back into the SR quickly. So here, phospholamban is phosphorylated and CIRCA is more active and you're able to store more calcium into the SR. So there's an increase in force, but also an increase in the velocities of contraction and relaxation. Now, this shows a more schematic overview. So you, as I indicated, PKA phosphorylates the different calcium handling proteins, increasing calcium cycling, but at the same time, multiple proteins of the myofilament apparatus are phosphorylated. So there's phosphorylation of myosin binding protein C, troponin I, and titin. And they all have a specific task in this in the regulation of contractility. So phosphorylation of myosin binding protein C regulates binding of the myosin heads, and once it's phosphorylated, these myosin heads can bind more quickly and detach more quickly. So myosin binding protein C is more of a brake on the myosin heads. When you phosphorylate it, the brake is taken away and you get a faster cycling of the myosin heads. Troponin I phosphorylation decreases the sensitivity of the myofilaments to calcium, and that will lead to a faster release of calcium from your myofilaments to have faster relaxation. So it can be pumped back into the SR really quickly. And then titin phosphorylation reduces the passive stiffness of your cardiac muscle cells, makes them more flexible, which also makes it more easy to for the heart to fail. So they all have their specific task in regulating cardiac function during exercise. This is shown, again, the different pathways, so PKA phosphorylation of the different calcium handling proteins, but also of the myofilament proteins. And there's this tight interaction between the myofilaments and the calcium handling proteins. So on the one side, you have a faster release and a faster reuptake of calcium, which basically increases your contractility and your relaxation. So that's regulated by the calcium handling proteins. And at the other side, at the myofilament side, mostly is regulating a faster relaxation. So phosphorylation of the myofilaments is really important to get a proper relaxation of your cardiac myocytes. And if you look at the myofilaments again, so how does this work? What changes when you activate these myofilaments? If you look at this dose response curve, at how much force is developed in response to calcium, when you activate your beta-adrenergic system and there's activation of protein kinase A, this curve shifts to a lower sensitivity, meaning that you have lower force development, but the main thing is that calcium is released really quickly from the myofilaments. And titin phosphorylation is regulating this part, so it lowers the passive stiffness and the hearts are better, are able to relax really well. So just to really put it in your brain, there's this interaction between calcium handling and the level of calcium which is released from the myofilaments and needs to be taken up by the SR to get a very fast relaxation of the cardiac muscle cell. So if you then go back and look at how the these are just two studies where they looked at patients with systolic and diastolic heart failure, or HFrEF and HFpEF, and looked at the response to beta-adrenergic stimulation. They find different responses, and the main observation is that if you look in the diastolic heart failure, the contractility response is preserved, but the relaxation is impaired, while in systolic heart failure, it's evident that the response to dobutamine in the increase in contractility is highly blunted. So these different patient groups respond different to a stimulation to dobutamine, to beta-adrenergic stimulation, indicating that the cellular mechanisms are different in these forms of cardiac disease. And a thing we studied together with Professor Dunker, who will also present to you during this meeting, we studied what happens with the beta-adrenergic stimulation signaling after myocardial infarction, which would lead to systolic heart failure. So there's this beautiful pig model where they introduced a coronary artery ligation to introduce a myocardial infarction. And the nice thing is that you can do a lot of measurements in vivo looking at the heart function. And if you look, put these pigs on a treadmill, what was observed that if you, after a severe myocardial infarction, to maintain function, the sympathetic activation in your whole body is increased, and that's shown here. The noradrenaline levels go up to a higher level in the infarct animals, sort of as a rescue to maintain cardiac output. You get beta-adrenergic activation, but you can see that the cardiac output, it's not sufficient to increase the cardiac output to the levels observed in the sham-operated animals. So there's severe overstimulation of your beta-adrenergic receptor pathway, but it's not sufficient to maintain cardiac output. Now, if you then look at what happens in the cardiac hearts or in the heart of samples which have seen chronic beta-adrenergic receptor stimulation, we see that the pKa targets, which are phosphorylated by upon beta adrenergic stimulation, is significantly lowered. So this shows a gel which is stained with an overall protein chain stain and a stain which recognizes phosphorylation of proteins. And you can see that the level of myosin binding protein C phosphorylation and troponin I, both targets of protein kinase A, is significantly lower compared to non-failing hearts. And this is the average of the different samples. So different hearts with systolic heart failure compared to non-failing hearts show a severe reduction in pKa phosphorylation of the target proteins. This is another way by which you can analyze phosphorylation status of your proteins, and this also shows the different levels of troponin I phosphorylation. We call it the FosTAC analysis. And again, we show very low levels or non-phosphorylated levels of troponin I in the failing hearts compared to the donor tissue. So to summarize, in systolic heart failure, you have this overstimulation, or after myocardial infarction, you have an overstimulation of beta adrenergic receptors. This will lead to a downregulation of these receptors, downregulation of cyclic AMP, and you get less phosphorylation of your target proteins. All proteins are less phosphorylated, also calcium handling proteins. And if you look at the myofilaments, this will increase your calcium sensitivity, and it will increase passive stiffness. So it will limit a relaxation of the heart. So going back to what would happen at the myofilament level, indeed, if you compare cardiac myocytes or the myofilaments from non-failing hearts to the end-stage failing hearts with systolic heart failure, you see that this calcium force relationship is shifted to the left, meaning that for a certain level of calcium, there's a higher force development. This would be good for contractility, but in particular, it would limit your relaxation. So we believe it's very bad for the diastolic phase of your heart. To show that this difference between the non-failing and the failing hearts is related to lower pKa-mediated phosphorylation, these measurements were repeated after adding exogenous protein kinase A, and then you can correct this difference between the non-failing and the failing hearts. So it's really due to these defects in the beta adrenergic signaling. So there's, after an insult such as a myocardial infarction, there's a whole downregulation of the signaling pathway leading to lower pKa-mediated phosphorylation at the level of the calcium hindering proteins, but also at the level of the myofilament proteins. And this shift in calcium sensitivity is always a question: when do you use animal models, and when do you can you do studies in a human model? We now have also more iPSC-derived models, which Thomas Eschenhagen will talk about to you. But in the animal models, we find this characteristic of a high calcium sensitivity in all models, although the change is smallest in the mouse model, and it's sort of similar in the pig model and the human model. So if you look at which cellular factors cause systolic dysfunction in patients with heart failure, it's reduced ejection fraction, it's altered expression of proteins, a reduction in circa, it's changes in the phosphorylation, and of course there's also cardiomyocyte death. And Professor DeLisa will talk to you about mitochondrial changes in the next lecture. But what happens with people who have diastolic heart failure? So those studies started about a bit more than 10 years ago, because we were not so aware of this patient group. And one of the first studies which was performed in biopsies from patients who have PEF, so diastolic heart failure, was done where comparison was made between samples collected from patients which have preserved ejection fraction but a very high filling pressure, so diastolic dysfunction, compared to the control group. And Attila Borbély did these measurements, a very good clinical cardiologist, but also doing his PhD. And what he found is that when looking at the passive stiffness, so at very low calcium concentration, There's a very high passive stiffness compared to the controls. And we had never seen that, and we actually first thought that it was an artifact. So we forced Attila to redo these measurements a lot of times. And in the end, we finally, believed him that it was not an artifact. And also, we thought, like, maybe we can correct it again. If we add protein kinase A, maybe it's related to a change in phosphorylation of the proteins. And indeed, when he repeated the measurements after pKa incubation, he could largely correct this high stiffness of the cardiomyocytes. So we are looking here at this part of the curve. There's a high passive stiffness in samples from patients which have PEF. And this parameter also correlated with the high filling pressure measured in the patient. So the higher the passive force, the higher filling pressures. Well, we now know, and I'll go quickly through this, that these changes, this high stiffness is regulated by a giant protein, titin, and phosphorylation of titin can change stiffness of the sarcomeres. So we now know that many different kinases change the stiffness, so pKa and pKg are the good ones. They actually lower your passive stiffness, while, for instance, pKc is increasing stiffness. And stiffness can also be changed by a change in isoform composition. You have a very compliant isoform and a stiff isoform. And we know that during heart failure, the heart is compensating by changing the isoform of the titin. So it moves to a more compliant isoform, and that appears to be a trigger caused by the increase in fibrosis in the heart and triggered by the changes in phosphorylation of titin. So we also studied the titin isoform composition in the different heart samples of the patient, and we could confirm the observation that in the heart failure samples, there's a shift to a more compliant titin isoform, but that doesn't explain the high passive stiffness. So it's really sort of a compensatory mechanism for the high passive stiffness of the cardiomyocytes. What we now know and think is that it's not a defect in pKa signaling, but also protein kinase G, which is regulated by NO, and cyclic GMP is activated and then leads to activation of protein kinase G, that there's low pKg mediated phosphorylation of titin, and that is due to a more systemic oxidative stress in the body in people who have diastolic heart failure. And that's sort of the overview is given here. So this was proposed by Walter Paulus, sort of a paradigm where the different comorbidities that we know occur in these patients, they have obesity, hypertension, that they change the vasculature in the body, and that there's sort of a chronic inflammation at the level of the endothelial cells leading to oxidative stress and a downregulation of this pKg-mediated phosphorylation of titin, which would then increase stiffness of your cardiomyocytes. So this is now the working hypothesis. And if you then put the two different forms of heart failure next to each other, what we basically think is people with HFrEF, so reduced ejection fraction, it starts in the cardiomyocytes, there are defects, the cardiac myocytes are changed and lowering your cardiac function, while the paradigm which people work with now, or many people work with, is that HFpEF starts in the vasculature, and endothelial changes have an effect on your cardiomyocyte function. So this just is another overview picture. We have the different comorbidities affecting your vasculature, leading to a chronic inflammation in your body, and this will lead to this interaction between the endothelial, the vasculature, and the cardiac muscle cells. And this crosstalk is highly impaired in patients with HFpEF. So if you think about treatment which has been optimized for the group of HFrEF patients. That's failing in HFpEF patients, but you can imagine because the cellular mechanisms are totally different in these forms of heart failure. So some last take-home message for you, how if you're studying HFpEF or HFrEF or any other interaction between, for instance, vasculature and the cardiac muscle cells, how can you study these? Well, you can use a lot of nice imaging tools nowadays to look in patient groups, but those are really often very expensive. We have animal models. I'll show you two, which I think are nowadays most resembling HFpEF. But what you can also use, and that's what we invested in Amsterdam a lot, is using co-cultures. So you could study the effect of endothelial dysfunction on cardiac muscle cells by building co-cultures of different cell types. And Rio Juni just set up a co-culture of endothelial cells, or this is on a matrix, and this is on the interaction of endothelial cells and cardiomyocytes. So Elsa van Deel in our group studied the interaction between the cardiac myocytes and the extracellular matrix, so you could isolate cardiac muscle cells from your isolated heart preparation, and you can seed them onto a different matrix, and after that you can detach them again, and then you can study sort of the effect of the extracellular matrix on cardiomyocyte function using the different contractility assays. Well, the animal model which is currently well established for the rats is the obese ZSF1 hybrid rat, where a diabetic rat is crossed with a hypertensive rat. So this has been well characterized. It's developed by the group in Porto, and if you are interested in the model, I would definitely go to these papers to read them. And the last paper, which you may have already seen, which is really important if you are working in the field of HFpEF, but it's anyways important, is a mouse model which was developed by Gabriele, I always pronounce his name, Schiattarella. Schiattarella. And he's a brilliant postdoc working in the group of Joe Hill. And they recently made a mouse model which very much recapitulates the different characteristics of HFpEF. So I'm sure this model will be used a lot in coming years to try to figure out new treatments for HFpEF. Okay, I think this is the take-home message. So I hope I convince you that at the cellular level there are a lot of differences between HFrEF and HFpEF, and this makes life in the clinic currently not easy because all the medication which is out there and has been tested in big clinical trials for HFrEF do not work for HFpEF. So there's still an urgent need to find new medication which is working for the HFpEF patients. Okay, this was my last slide. Thank you for listening, and I'm happy to answer questions. Okay. Questions? Jump up.
Come on.
Fabio, you have a question? No. Yes? Oh, there's a question. Oh. Your topic. Cool. Okay. Could you go to the microphone? Or, oh, someone's. Cool. Thanks.
Hi, thank you for a very nice talk. I was just wondering about the co-cultures you briefly mentioned. Did you have co-cultures with both endothelial cells and fibroblasts and cardiomyocytes?
No, not yet, but I mean that's also doable. So and there are a lot of different systems now. I hope Thomas Eschenhagen will also give an overview of the different possibilities and where we are now. For instance, we just did a study where we used human endothelial cells, but on rat cardiomyocytes. So we have to work with the things we now have. The human cells, the iPS-derived cardiomyocytes are often still rather fetal, except if you put them in a 3D structure. So, yeah, now things start moving. There are systems, and it really depends on the question you want to address. okay, in your essay. You. Maybe it's nice if you say who you are and where you're from.
Yeah, yeah. I'm Caroline from Norway.
Okay, nice, yeah. No? Oh, yeah. Questions in the back.
Hello, I'm André from Portugal. Thank you for your talk, it was very interesting. I was wondering about HalfPath, if you have any potential tips on how a basic researcher would approach the challenge of the heterogeneity of clinical risk factors and manifestation of HFF and the different maybe subgroups of HFF patients that we observe in the clinic. Do you have any idea how we could how we could approach this from a translational perspective?
Yeah, the problem is, of course, that you still cannot measure. I mean, we had biopsies where pressure volume loops were made, so we were very sure that it was HFpEF. I am aware of better, I should look it up. There's a recent clinical, but you may know it, a classification of the different HFpEF subgroups. Yeah, I think classification is key. And then if you are able, I would certainly collect blood samples, because I think that will help us in the future to better classify them, hopefully with biomarker panels. And once we then know what's changing at the cellular level at a certain phase, we may be able to target the different subgroups within HFpEF. So if you're a clinical researcher, make sure you do very good clinical phenotyping and collect whatever you can from these people and wait until good assays are become available. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Oh, and yeah, what I also like is, and what's sort of is that you, for instance, use the cardiomyocyte assay and you expose the cardiomyocytes to your serum samples of the patients. So if you would have very good characterized cohorts of patients, you may get really nice answers there. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Patrick Nacolet, I am an old PhD student, so maybe I can ask you questions. So do you think that heart failure with the preserved ejection fractions had the capacity to produce acute heart failure as well as heart failure with the reduction of ejection fractions?
Yeah, so the first question, acute heart failure, is like, yeah, they have acute problems because they have, if the filling is really impaired, they often get to the clinic. But I'm not a cardiologist. Maybe a cardiologist could answer. They have severe acute edema, and you should dehydrate them, right?
The ejection can be strictly the same.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so then you don't you can't distinguish the HFrEF from the HFpEF patients. Yeah, yeah. And the second question was, that's the question, yeah. So yeah, the clinical presentation is difficult, right? Yeah, yeah, to distinguish, yeah. Last question.
It's a short one. Thank you. Antoine from Brussels, Belgium. I was just wondering what is the time frame of the phosphorylation issue that you mentioned us, meaning is it something that you can study in acute phase of myocardial infarction, or does it require weeks and months to be really relevant?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think there's still rather limited information. If you think about a myocardial infarction, and Fabio De Lisa may talk about it, if you have an acute insult, there are, for instance, at the myofilament level, other changes than the ones I've shown for the lowering of the beta-adrenergic phosphorylation via the beta-adrenergic signaling. So it's very much phase-dependent. But, for instance, for the HFpEF and when titin phosphorylation changes occur, that's still not resolved. But, yeah. Okay.